Good evening to all. This is Shilpa Iyer, the Membership Director of the ISC2 Bangalore Chapter, and I, on behalf of all the board members, extend a warm welcome to you all on our webinar series, and a special welcome to all our chapter members who have recently joined us. It's a shame that we haven't got a chance to meet you and network with you personally. However, we hope we are able to do that and a lot more in the months to come. Meanwhile, do feel free to network on our WhatsApp knowledge group and LinkedIn group as well. Today's topic is coordinated approach towards ICS cybersecurity. But before we move on, a couple of housekeeping items. Now, I'll be moderating initially and stepping out, and later I'll be moderating the questions that come from you. So do post all your questions in the Q&A section, and we will do our best to get all of them addressed by the end of this webinar. And now, as you all know, the presentation is brought to you from our homes. So we do apologize if there is any unforeseen interruptions, but we will try our best to make this a flawless presentation for you. So thank you all for your participation. All ISC2 members will get one CPE for attending this session, and the webinar will be recorded and it will be available for you to view or to share by the end of the week. So now, without further ado, it gives me absolute pleasure to hand over the mic to our presenter, Daniel, who will be introducing himself. The floor is all yours, Daniel. Thank you.
Good afternoon to all connected people from India. It is my pleasure to talk to you today afternoon from Israel. And as you know, Israel is very active in the area of cybersecurity, and my special activity is in the area of industrial control systems. Little bit about my background. I started in 1976 as an engineer and continued my career in engineering. And around 2010, when the Stuxnet event happened, I started my involvement with industrial control system cybersecurity at Siemens. Later, I continued with Waterfall. And during the past over 5 years, I'm dealing with cybersecurity consulting, lecturing, and so on. Altogether, over 44 years of industrial activity. Little bit about industrial control systems. And as you can see, there is a short list, actually almost a complete list of applications where we can see industrial control systems, starting with water. Water is actually the most highly important application because we all rely on supply of fresh and potable water at the right and the correct pressure, electricity, environment, water treatment, desalination control is very important, oil and gas communication, public safety, siren systems, obviously transportation, and finally, the last application which we see more and more is cybersecurity for building and energy management systems. I'm not talking about the home buildings, but mostly about government building, where we need to assure a high business continuity, and when we must prevent absolutely a cyber attack on these activities. We have seen many examples about hospitals where people manage to break into the system and cause operating shutdown. So these are the main applications that we are focusing. Obviously, in every country, people can find additional application. Don't forget the recent introduction of the Industrial Internet of Things, and I will little bit talk about it in between, because it is definitely a significant event, because it makes the systems operating much better, more accurately. However, don't forget that adding every sensor and every component increase the the cyber attack surface. I would like to introduce you in this picture the structure of the organization. It is not the complete Purdue model that usually you see, but a simplified but a very clear model, specifically tuned for industrial control applications, where you can see the three layers, the field level, the sensors, PLCs, RTUs, about the communication and control, and finally the HMI. So these are the main levels of the industrial control systems. Above that, we used to have air gap for many years, and the air gap was usually isolating the industrial control system from the enterprise, because the enterprise is connected to the internet. I must clearly say that in 2010, when the Stuxnet attack happened, people realized that air gap is not a protection. Why? Because the Stuxnet was an internally generated cyber attack, meaning that it was not done through the internet. It was done by someone penetrating to the facility, getting very close to the control system, and causing damage to that system. So what happened after 2010? Organizations, for purpose of improved operating productivity, started connecting the enterprise to the industrial control system, obviously very careful connection, very secure connection, but they started to connect them because they realized that the air gap is not protecting them at all. And in order to improve the operating productivity, and I want to make it very clear, the operating productivity, not for other reason, they started to do connections between the IT and the OT. Some people try to call it today IT-OT convergence. I personally don't like this term, because these two systems, the IT and the ICS, were separately designed, separately built, separately commissioned, and they will actually never converge. They will be carefully interconnected for purpose of moving the data from the industrial session side to the operation side in order to improve productivity. But as I said, and remember that, we should not call it convergence, because convergence means like actually systems are getting glued together, which will not happen. Why it will not happen? For one reason. One very important reason: IT systems are protected through the CIA, confidentiality, integrity, availability, as we all know. Industrial control systems are connected not through IAC on the all kind of rotating of these words, but I clearly say SRP, safety, reliability, and productivity. So, as you can see, major differences on at the IT, we are protecting the confidentiality of the data. In the industrial control systems, OT, we are protecting the safety. And these are very different goals. I would like to show here an architecture of a typical organization. And as you can see on the left side, you see the industrial control system. In the middle, you see the IT system. And on the right side, you see the remote attacker connecting. And on the left side, you see the PLC, which is actually the target for the attacker. We can call it the crown jewel. This is the PLC which someone wants to attack, because they can destroy the pump or the turbine or any machinery. Between the IT and the OT, you show here a firewall, but it's definitely not, it should not be a firewall, because firewalls are not strong enough. Although there are today modern firewalls, in many cases, we are putting a unidirectional diode, I will talk about it later, or we are putting a demilitarized zone, something much stronger than a firewall. So you see here the two sides, the IT and the ICS OT. They are connected securely, but for purpose of moving critical data. And we will go further. If you will have any question to that, please keep it for the end of the webinar, and I will explain it further. Which are the real threats? When we are speaking about the threat to the industrial control system, as you can see, there is a broad range of threat. Starting with on the left side, that these systems were not designed for operating for cybersecurity in mind. Going to the right with different factors, but on the center, I put the people factor. Why did I put the people factor? Because remember, I don't know what is the number, 80%, 90%, 95%, doesn't matter, of the successful attacks were created due to negligent behavior of people. So if we invest in training people, if in boosting their awareness, teaching them, making sure that they are aware of what can happen if they do something wrong, we can significantly reduce the number of cyber attack on the industrial operation. Furthermore, most important is the risk reduction through hardening. Why? In the past, we were using proprietary computers made for the industrial operation, proprietary control systems. Today, we are using commercial off-the-shelf. The standard PC computer is used in the industrial facility, exactly the same one that our kids are using at home. So in order to make it suitable for industrial operation, we must do something what we call hardening, meaning adapt the computer or the PLC for environment where someone may try to damage the operation. So later you can read carefully the list, but obviously the list is much, much longer than what I show here. Why handling of industrial control system defense is difficult? Because we are, in many cases, we see outdated hardware and software. Because these systems are operating around the clock and you cannot interfere with them. Because unfortunately, many organizations, the water utilities and some smaller utilities, they don't have the experts who can deal with that. Okay, so what can we do in many cases? We need to study and we need to find out the list of external complementing and compensating measures. What can be done without interrupting the operation, without replacing the computers, without replacing the PLCs and the sensors, in order to strengthen the process. So briefly telling about the three main vectors of the cyber attack. First, we are talking about the most critical, the internally generated cyber attack, what happened at the Stuxnet in Iran in 2010, when someone penetrated to the facility. We don't know who did it, doesn't matter. We don't know exactly who was the person who actually took the action, but for sure it was an internal action because the entire organization was disconnected from the internet. Then we are talking about the externally generated cyber attack through the internet. Always it starts with social engineering and on. It starts with gradual compromising the safety barriers in the system. And very important to know that before you see the result of the attacker may sit in your system, collect data for 100 to 200 days. It's crazy that you can think somebody is in your system for over half a year and collecting information about your process, about your computers, about IP addresses, MAC addresses, types of PLCs, the process and so on, and preparing the big attack. Finally, don't forget the supply chain attack, your vendors, your subcontractors, your service suppliers. Everyone can become, for whatever reason, a cyber attacker. So these are the main vectors, but obviously when you will deal with your operation, you need to go very deeply, and you need to even work with a consultant who can help you to identify the situation. Which are the main attacks? Obviously, there is a whole list of attacks, but I would like to bring a few examples. The man in the middle attack, when somebody is connecting into your industrial system, somehow collecting the data and exporting the data. Denial of service or distributed denial of service, but typically denial of service when somebody is injecting a troublemaking malware to your industrial control system and making it very busy, meaning that the PLC cannot talk to the call to your HMI because the network is busy. Stealing business data, it's very important. Why? We are not stealing here credit card data. We are stealing here information about preparing a larger attack, IP addresses, types of computers, types of PLCs, learning the process and so on. Finally, ransomware. Usually ransomware is attack on the IT system, but if somebody can penetrate to your organization and pass through the barrier between the IT and the ICS, he can also encrypt the operation data. Little bit about the terms. Everybody knows the term zero day, but I want to be more accurate on this. We need to talk about zero day vulnerability, the vulnerability which was not known until yesterday, but today it's known. We need to talk about zero day exploit. Exploit is the action which is allowing the attack to happen. And finally, the zero day the attack, what is very typical, that because zero day is a process which was unknown until yesterday, we are not prepared for that. It's very similar like we are living in the COVID-19 period, that it come to us and we were not prepared because we didn't know anything about it, and suddenly it is attacking us and we don't know what to do. It takes us time until we organize ourselves and learn how to protect ourselves. The next terminology, very important, advanced persistent threat. Advanced persistent threat is not a simple attack. It is the type of attack that it's targeted and conducted by a nation. Meaning that they have the resources, they have the experts, they have the tools, and they will conduct the attack until they will be successful. No doubt about it. So if any organization, I don't want to call it your organization, if any organization is targeted by an APT type attack, you must assume that the attacker will be successful. If you want to see the definition about the risk level, you can study the ISA 62443 standard. And if you go to security level 4, it will explain you what does it mean, APT type attack, when people have the resources, the people, the motivation. There is no limit. Somebody is telling you, take unlimited budget, take unlimited resources, hire the expert. But what you need, you must be successful in this attack. Well, I think you will be successful. And this is a very risky situation. Let's define a little bit, what does it mean risk? When we speak about risk, we need to talk about two parameters. We need to talk about the probability. What is the probability that something will happen? Obviously, if you ask what is the probability that a nation-type attacker will attack your home computer, probably very low. So you don't need to worry about it. And what is the impact? The impact is the level of damage. People may steal your data. People may modify your bank account. People may destroy the machinery. People may create an explosion. So people, unfortunately, must die. So this is the impact. And obviously, the higher is the probability and the higher is the impact, the risk is much higher. So what is the risk? Is it some type of multiplication? There are different formulas in different countries, but typically people multiply the probability level and the impact level, and they create the risk level. If anyone is interested, I published a paper about it later. I can provide you a link to that paper, which explains this topic. You see the green color and the red color, obviously, the level 25 is a very high risk. I would like to show this picture. This picture is showing you, and we are speaking about industrial control system. We are not speaking about a bank or about a credit card or about a database. We are speaking about the industrial process, a refinery and a chemical plant, an ammonia, a factory which is using ammonia. So you see here the different levels. In the bottom, in the green, you see normal operation. Normal operation, some parameters, the temperature, pressure can go a little bit higher, lower, but this is normal. In the blue color, you see deviation. Deviation, which for whatever reason, the temperature increase above the normal. It's not risky, but it's above the normal. So you see that the operator can do some intervention. He can do something, reduce the pressure, reduce the temperature, open some emergency valve, or slow down the process. And then if he's successful, then obviously the parameter will come back to the green level. But how about a situation when that operator is sleeping or is unable to do it because it happened during the night time? The temperature, the pressure will continue to increase. And then we need what we know, the safety layer, the safety instrument system. Okay, when we have the safety instrument system, there's an automatic system which should do the same thing which the operator was supposed to do slightly later, but we are still not at risk. If for example, what happened in Saudi Arabia, that the Triton event in, I believe, 2 years ago, that somebody disabled the safety layer, then in that event, we were lucky because it was discovered. But if the safety valve or the safety operation disabled, it can go to higher level and go out of control. And unfortunately, it may go to fire, explosion, big damage, and so on. So all those people who are dealing with industrial control system, you must remember that we are not dealing about confidentiality of data. We are dealing about safety and protecting lives of people. This is what we need to remember from this slide. So let's talk a little bit about how we are protecting our system. Obviously, there is no single measure, there is no single process that can help us to stop absolutely the risk. So on the left side, you see a sort of layered process. You see the perimeter security, the endpoint security, network security. These are illustrations. But how to implement these illustrations? You must go to your own facility and understand how each and every computer, controller, process are working, and see what kind of safety barriers you can do in order to reduce the risk. On the right side, you see the famous PPT triad, people, policies and processes and technologies. You can clearly see that the people is on the top. Why? I already mentioned it earlier. The 80, 90, 95%, whatever, a very high percentage of successful cyber attacks were allowed but due to negligence of people. So awareness, training, drills, everything is highly important. On the left side, you see the policies and processes. Every organization must have it. And finally, the technologies. Technologies are very important. They are available. But as I mentioned earlier, in many cases, it is not so easy to deploy them because organizations may not have the budget. They cannot stop the operation of the ICS. They don't have the people, or the factory is running around the clock and you cannot stop it. So all cyber defense is done by the PPT triad and layered defense. This is what you need to remember from this slide. I would like to specifically mention here, because many people are probably aware of the standard application. I would like to show here a little bit about the building and energy management systems, because it is a new application. We are speaking here about the DC, the data center. We are speaking here about the underground facility where the generators, their conditions, and the chillers are located must be protected. We need to worry about external utility equipment, like external supply of electricity, external supply of water, and dealing with sewage, all are very important. We need to worry about the crack. Crack is the computer room air conditioning, which is actually cooling the data center. The HVAC, the heat ventilation and air conditioning system. We need to worry about smoke and fire detection systems. Just imagine in this building, somebody will activate the fire alarm and 1,000 people will run out of the building. We already created the damage. How long it will take you to bring back the people and tell them nothing happened, all good. So this is related to building, and what can you do? You can consistently run assessment of what can happen, who can attack, how can people attack you, external, internal supply chain, what can be the impact, shutdown of electricity, shutdown of water, shutdown of air conditioning, shutdown of the data center, what can happen? How effective are your defense measures? You need to evaluate it, and sometimes you need an expert to help you. When you are organizing yourself, okay, what I'm going to do? You need to do the risk assessment. You can see here again the formula, the risk formula, taking into consideration the probability and the impact. Evaluate the worst case, what can happen, and always think which are the effective and cost-effective and possible to deploy cyber cyber defense measure. So this is what is important. A little bit about technologies. I already mentioned that the firewall itself is not a strong enough measure because there are some critical facilities. For example, the historian server where we have all the data stored, or some type of engineering computer, or some type of terminal server for handling it. They must be located highly secured. So what we are doing with the DMZ is the demilitarized zone. In the demilitarized zone, we have two firewalls, and practically what is happening that the data cannot go from one side, from the corporate network to the ICS network directly. It must go somehow through the DMZ. And also in the opposite direction, data cannot go from ICS to the corporate network. It must go through the DMZ. In the DMZ, you can perform all kinds of functions. You can do deep packet inspection. You can do changing of the protocol. You can analyze the data. Is this data supposed to go out or supposed to go in? Is there any malware in the data which somebody is trying to send from the corporate network to the ICS? So the terminal server or some type of deep packet inspection computer can always perform this function. Another very effective measure is the unidirectional gateway, what we call data diode. Data diode, very important to know this product. This is the only one in cyber defense which is not software-based as firewall, DMZ, or other. They are all software-based. It is hardware-based, and there is only one transmitter and one receiver, and data can only go out from the industrial control system to the corporate network, and no data can go from the corporate network to the industrial control system. So this is the one-way communication. You can learn about it, how it is working. It's not a new product. It's existing about well over 10 years. And you can definitely use it. You must be careful where it is applicable. It's not applicable everywhere, but there are areas where definitely you can use it. Another topic is the anomaly-based intrusion or anomaly-based or signature-based intrusion detection system. The anomaly-based intrusion detection system is very, very effective because it is actually analyzing the data. Analyzing the data, you are looking for something that you don't know what to expect. The signature-based IDS or the signature-based firewall, you are looking for something that you are looking for the guy with the blue hat. But in the anomaly-based, you are looking for a guy who is coming without a hat, something unusual, something that you do not expect. Definitely, these are very strong tools. Today, they are widely available. They have many advantages. Also, some disadvantage because it takes some learning time until they learn what is normal, what is acceptable. But definitely, intrusion detection systems are a very critical component in detecting especially zero-day type attack. What is zero-day? Something that you don't know what to expect. So if you have an IDS and the IDS is detecting something unusual, the system doesn't know what it is, but it says this is, for example, unusual traffic, unusual rate of data moving to a certain zone. These are anomaly conditions, must be detected. Finally, we need to talk about the SIM. the security information and event management. Some people call it SIEM and SIEM SOC, but I would say that there is no SOC. SOC is the Security Operations Center, where you have the analysts who are looking at what is happening around the country. But you cannot operate a SOC without a SIEM. The SIEM is a system which is collecting data from all possible devices, from firewalls, from computers, from PLCs, from everywhere, a different type of logs. Different type of logs from different sources, and the SIEM is a system which was built as a dedicated tool to identify any type of attack. Okay, so what we have. We have the SIEM, which is collecting information from IDS, from the firewall, and from every computer. The SIEM is analyzing the data and sending it to the SOC. In the SOC, there are intelligent people who can analyze it and find out what is happening. Another application, I will just briefly call it. Many people today, especially today, are talking about the necessity of remote access. Why? Because people cannot go to work, people need to connect from home. So here is an idea about how you can use. It's the specific application of the unidirectional gateway, which is capturing data from the screen, sending it a unidirectional to another expert in another city, in another country, and the expert is guiding the person on site and explaining him how the process can be completed without the need that the expert will fly and arrive actually on site, because he cannot do it. It's a very fast operation. So think about it. It's a good application. It is not, especially if you already have a unidirectional gateway, you can upgrade it, what we call remote screen view. A little bit about the standards. Obviously, we need to protect our system. There is a wide range of standards for different industries. And the biggest problem is that these standards are time-consuming. You need to learn it, how to use it. So for electricity companies, people use the NERC. For our IT organization, people use the ISO 27001. And for industrial control system, people use the NIST 882, the 53. And finally, the ISO 62443, which is the new standard. Actually, the 62443, you must remember it. This is the only standard which is telling you how to implement cybersecurity for your organization and for your system. So very important to allocate a team who will study the 62443, and this may help you to upgrade the cybersecurity of your organization. And another well-known is the NIST Cybersecurity Framework version 1.1. It is not a standard. However, it is a free download document. You can read it about best practices, read the topic, but it is not a standard. It will teach you how to do certain things. Identify, protect, detect, respond, and so on. What you need to do, how you assure the business continuity and the disaster recovery. Oh, it's written there nicely, but remember, it is not a standard. However, very convenient reading. It's for free download, and I definitely encourage everyone to read it. The real standard, as I already mentioned, IEC 62443. This is the only standard which will become in the future the true the true and the most important document for protecting the system. So I show here the introduction slide, but it definitely takes a lot of efforts to learn it. I would start with the one-day introduction class, so you know what it's all about, and later people can go. This standard is written well over 1,000 pages. It has 14 sections in four groups, but as I said, this is the only standard that you need to remember. A little bit about the standard. We have just a few more minutes before we go to the Q&A session. I hope you already prepared your questions. So here we are talking about what I already mentioned, the zoning. What very important to understand the system in your organization and do separation to security zones and identify the conduits, the channels where the data is flowing between the zone. And once you have this type of chart, which is taken, by the way, from the 62443 standard, once you build this type of chart specifically for your system, your organization, and you are capable of breaking the architecture to zones and conduits, review the boundaries, understand where are the risks, then you make a huge step towards improved cybersecurity. As I said, you need to perform a periodic and consistent risk assessment. Remember, risk is the multiplication of the probability and the impact. You need to perform the risk assessment in order to understand where is the risk, where your critical assets are located, how to protect each asset, because obviously you cannot protect all devices, all computers, all PLCs with the same level of measure, same day defense measures. So if you have a fuel tank out in the yard and you're monitoring the level of the fuel, it must be monitored. But you don't need the same level of defense as you are talking about your boiler or talking about a turbine or a electric generator, which are higher risk installations. So remember this chart, think about it, how you create this chart or similar chart for your organization. Finally, I would like to remind you something. I hope it will not create you, put you in bad mood, but what is the true cost? I'm not sure if the word cost is the right word, but what you need to know about the cyber breach, the day after things happen, you have administration cost, legal cost, loss of revenue, incident cost, personal reputation of the managers in your organization. These are the things that people must remember. Finally, I would like to move to the Q&A session. But before we move to the Q&A session, remember these messages. Put security goals into your specification. Deal with vendors who take security seriously. Do not compromise on security requirements. And finally, the most difficult, always be ready for tomorrow's challenges. And I would like even to say tomorrow's surprising challenges, because you don't know what is coming today. So this completes my presentation, and we would like to move now to the Q&A session.
Thank you, Daniel. Thank you so much. I think on the behalf of the 100-plus attendees that we have here and myself, thank you. It was a very informative session. May I remind all the attendees here again that the webinar is recorded and it will be made available to view or to share by the end of the week. Now, I do have a set of questions compiled here from the audience, which I think, with your permission, Daniel, I would like to fire away. Starting with the first one that came almost immediately.
I see the questions. That's okay. See the questions. Perfect. So let's save time and move. There is a lot of talks about integration of IT and OT network, what you're talking about this, how best segregation can be done with minimal impact on both corporations. So this is what we just talked about. It. First of all, don't use the word integration. Don't use the word convergence. Think about creating and operating two separate systems and ask yourself, why do we need to connect them? What is the purpose? What kind of data we must move between these zones? And this will help you to understand. But this is a specific question to a specific system, so I cannot give a more complete answer. So second question is, how best you can implement secure remote access to industrial control system without compromising the availability, reliability, remote access? Well, I would like to say something brave here. Please avoid remote access. Not everybody will tell you that. I'm telling you, avoid, minimize remote access. And if you feel that you must do it, you make sure that your management, your CISO, your IT guys, everybody is aware of that. And then see who is connecting. Verify who is the person who is connecting. If this is the right person or this is an attacker, this is the biggest problem. You may talk to your friend and somebody is already monitoring it. Somebody already knows how the remote connection is done. And then at that night, he will connect. So there are technologies which can perform protection. As I said, use of unidirectional diode is very good, but it doesn't allow two-way connection. Use some type of strong next-generation firewalls. It can be good. But remember, all software-based defense can be compromised. So the question is, what is the risk level? If the risk level is very high, I would say prevent it. If the risk level is very low and it's only a small water pump or small water controller, you may allow to do it, take into consideration that something might happen. A third question, for compliance, IC system must be patched. So how will the diode... Okay, so first of all, I want to say again something bravely. You are allowed to do patching only if you verify that the patching software will not hurt the operating safety and reliability. This is the biggest problem. You do patching, but you don't know really what happened. It's not that you are receiving a Tuesday update from Microsoft. It's not the same. You have an application software, and you are patching this application. You have no clue that there must be some glitches in the patch, and something will go out of control. So in order to do patching, I do recommend that you have what we call a digital twin. An inactive system, a sort of a twin system, or if you can allocate, okay, I'm going to allocate 2 days for performing the patching. If I'm lucky, I will complete in half a day. If I go into trouble, I will have to rotate it back. So think about everything. Patching is important, but not so important that you will create a safety risk. What do you guys to offer protect against supply chain or on software patches? Same thing. Never buy an antivirus, never use an antivirus from the vendor. Why? because the vendor, if you can get the antivirus from the supplier of your HMI or your engineering station or the supplier of the PLC, and they already tested it, it's much better than to buy a commercial off-the-shelf patching software. Think about it. It's not simple, but for example, I know very well that people who are operating Siemens, I'm not promoting Siemens, but I remember from my career that the instruction was always to receive the antivirus not from the vendor, but from Siemens, because that antivirus was pre-tested. Question. How AI-based tools can prove to be a bond for detecting malware? Well, artificial intelligence is coming everywhere. Actually, it is a tool which is learning, which is collecting the data, which is analyzing what happened. Especially important when we are going to expand our systems with the industrial Internet of Things. What are we doing? We are adding sensors, we are adding controllers, and creating new type of vulnerabilities. So we need to compensate for that. Meaning that if you deploy some type of artificial intelligence, a tool, software, which is analyzing the condition, analyzing the process, then obviously the situation is slightly better. So yes, it is coming. Finally, there is a question, which is another presentation. What are the best practices for protecting against ICS attack? Well, we can roll back to the beginning of the presentation. We are talking about the PPT triad. I already said, number one, invest in people. Training, drills, so on. Create policies. Use technologies. Okay? Use technologies. Perform periodic cyber risk assessment. Okay? Bring experts. Look at it. What I want to carefully say, never do pen testing on a live system. Never. We never do pen testing. Why? Because pen testing is a good process for IT. However, if the pen tester is not expert, and he is not an expert, he's expert in pen testing, he's not expert in your ICS, if he will start to do a process and the PLC will crash, it will stop controlling the boiler and the boiler will explode. So what we did? We did a pen testing for purpose verifying the cyber secure condition, and we created an explosion. So no, never do that. Pen testing, yes, if you have a digital twin, a similar offline system, or for example, sometimes you shut down the factory for a holiday or for 2 weeks of machinery retrofitting and so on. Yeah, you can do it, but take into consideration that if any action you take, you need to be prepared how you are going to roll back. Okay, I give you one example. One day, I had a visitor and he came to do an upgrade, and I asked him how long it will take you. He said, if we are lucky, it will take us half a day. I told him, okay, take 2 days, not half a day. After the first day, if you didn't complete it, show me how you are going to roll it back. So these are the practices. We can talk about hours what can we do. I see more questions are coming. Okay, as we cannot install endpoint security controls on IC system, what can be done to secure the device. Well, some endpoint securities can be installed, but not as an add-on. During the design of the architecture, you can do many things. Usually, I prefer to talk about complementing and compensating security measures. This is very, very, very effective. Always think about the three attack vectors. The internally generated attack, how can you protect it? Very difficult. It can be your service provider. It can be a cleaning person. It can be, unfortunately and sadly, one of your employees, okay, who was threatened or whatever. And the physical security, you know how small today is the USB stick. People can bring it to the work and you cannot, absolutely cannot detect it. Okay? So always think about internal generated attack, meaning that questioning and monitoring all the people who are coming to a facility. Externally generated attack, make sure that your segregation between the IT network and the ICS network are as strong as possible. And supply chain, monitor your vendors, monitor your subcontractors. I would like to say something. Very good. Never allow a service person to bring his own laptop to your facility. Buy the laptop. Buy the software for analyzing your system. Why? Because that laptop, you don't know. And the service person doesn't know where it was connected yesterday. Or maybe when he gets home, his child was playing with the computer and some malware already penetrated to that computer. So one of the good practices, especially for critical facilities, and this is what I'm recommending to my customers, buy the laptop computer for service. It can still be used by the same service person. He's coming to your site, give him the laptop, he will do the work, return your laptop, put it to a safe place until next time he's coming. There will be a question of how to upgrade the software, but it's another process. How do you see the security threats and what are your suggestions to enable architecture when IIoT and cloud-based integration can replace traditional? Well, too many things. IIoT, industrial IIoT should be considered as part of the SCADA system. Okay, number one, it's a sort of remote sensor. It's a sort of there is a huge difference between IoT and IIoT. Some people who will search the internet, you will find some of my papers about the differences between IoT and IIoT, or I can send it if somebody is very much interested. When it comes to cloud, what are we going to move to the cloud? If we are going to move to the cloud a backup data using a one-way diode, it is okay. If we are going to move to the cloud some analyzing and IDS to the cloud, it is okay. But I don't see a situation that you have a sensor and the HMI will be a cloud-based HMI, okay? And you say, well, this is what I'm using. No. Although cloud and cloud communications are improving, but you must do risk assessment. What can be done if somebody is attacking your cloud service provider? What can be done what can happen if that HMI will not be available for a day? Do you have an alternative solution? And then we are going to a long discussion about BCP, the business continuity preparedness, about disaster recovery. This is a complete different presentation that you need to learn. Do you have a checklist or questionnaire based on when do we risk a seven plan or a 62443? Well, the 62443, as I said, it's a long document. Those people who are passing a complete training, the ISA training, like a 2 days, 3 days, or even a week training, they will receive this kind of questionnaires. Other alternative is to study by the standards. First of all, you need to know which paragraphs you need to buy, depending if you are a vendor of component, if you are integrator or you are an end user, depending what you are, which paragraphs you need to study, and you prepare your own list. Those of you who may be very much interested, there are like a one-day introduction webinars which we can arrange just for you to know the principles. But 62443, you cannot read it and start working. You need to go to a training class and talk to a trainer who will teach you all the topics about. We are ending the 1 hour session. If there are any more questions, I will be happy to answer. If there will be questions, as it was introduced, this webinar will be recorded and you can see the slides later. And if you will have any questions, my email is shown on the last screen, and anyone who want to send a question in privately or through the organization, everything is fine. I will do my best. If it is something that I can answer, if it is something that require in-depth work or perhaps some on-site meeting, it may be complicated these days, but definitely what is most important are the messages that you can see on this slide. And we live in the area that things are not going to improve. Cyber attackers are evolving. Crime organizations, nations are going to this war. And what is very important to remember, that according to ISO 27001-2013, responsibility on cybersecurity is on the shoulder of the top level management and the CEO. So you know now who is responsible, who should give you the resources, who should be responsible for hiring the experts, training the experts, conduct assessment, conduct drills, and the goal is clear. Make sure that you are ready for tomorrow's unexpected challenges. So with this, I see that there are no more questions are coming. So good evening to all the connected people, and I thank you for your time, that evening time that you dedicated to this webinar. It was my pleasure to bring you this important information. I see it as a mission to teach people, to make them aware, make them more professional to deal with these challenges. So thank you very much, and feel free to send more questions, or looking forward to some more detailed webinars.
Thank you, Daniel. Thank you again for coming out and providing this session to our members. And thank you, members. You've been a great audience. Anyone who wishes to join the Bangalore chapter, you can please send us an email on the membership ID that's sent out at the broadcast window, and I will bring you on board. On behalf of the board, I look forward to seeing you all in our next webinar. Have a great evening. We'll conclude our session here. Thank you.
Thank you.